expired in about 2 weeks.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm
Mary Louise Elvin.
I'm a local refugee.
I'm
pleased to welcome you to Parliament today. The topic of our meeting is UNRWA, its activities and funding, and perpetuating statelessness. And we have three expert speakers and the film, which we're going to show before we go to questions and comments from you. So I'd like to start by introducing our first speaker, Bassem Eid, director of Palestinian Human Rights Monitoring Group. Bassem was born in Jerusalem. He spent the first 33 years of his life in the Rafah refugee camp on the outskirts of Jerusalem, and became a prominent figure in the first intifada as senior field researcher for the Israeli Information Centre for Human Rights in the occupied territories. So, Bassem.
Thank you. We Palestinians can no longer deny our responsibility for the destiny of our people. For 26 years, I have been devoting my life to the mission of defending human rights in the occupied colonies. I have seen worse and terrible, unfortunately. I live in Jerusalem, as mentioned. I was brought up in United Nations Relief and Works Agency, UNRWA, refugee camp in Shafat, a refugee camp like 58 other UNRWA refugee camps created for the sole purpose of keep the Palestinian Arab people in temporary conditions. For 66 years, under the false pretense and specious promise of the right of return in the pre-1948 villages, which has no exist anymore. As a proud Palestinian, I must take responsibility for what will happen to our people. We can no longer deny our responsibility for the future of our people. UNRWA, to continue its operation, depends on death and the visual suffering of 5 million Palestinians who continue to wallow in and around the UNRWA facilities. The more Palestinians suffer, the more power goes to UNRWA, which allows it to raise unchecked humanitarian funds and pursues munitions. People ask, why not abolish UNRWA? Well, this cannot be done. The only agency that can abolish UNRWA is the UN General Assembly, which has never had the interests of the Palestinian people at heart. After all, the UN rakes in more than 1.2 billion a year as an incentive to continue our status as refugee. People ask, why not ask donor nations to defund UNRWA? Do they not realize that Western defunding of UNRWA would allow nations like Qatar to enter the battle? Leaving the West with no leverage over UNRWA policies, the point is to influence donor nations to reform UNRWA and predicate a future aid to UNRWA under the following conditions. Audit all funds allocated to UNRWA, which operates within the 1.2 billion budget. Introduce UN High Commissioner for Refugee Standards to UNRWA and encourage a permanent refugee settlement. Cancel the UNRWA war curriculum based on principles of jihad, martyrdom, and right of return for the force of force by force or arms. Demand the UNRWA school conform to the UNRWA slogan, peace starts here. Dismiss the UNRWA employees affiliated with such organizations like the Hamas, defined by the donor nations to UNRWA as a terrorist entity. It is therefore the responsibility of the Palestinian people to rebel against the arbitrary administration of UNRWA, which seeks to prorogate our refugee status instead of helping our people to strive for a better future. UNRWA not conducted a census within the refugee camps for some 2 decades. And so the organization cannot know how many Palestinian refugees are living in the camps, if it is in the occupied territories and in the diaspora. To this day, the number remains unclear of the refugees. While some sources say there are 2.5 million refugees, and the Palestinian Authority claims that the number is higher than 6 million refugees. UNRWA, which should be the authoritative source, is keeping silence. So, on the figures, is UNRWA basing its request for the funds? Do the contributing countries have an idea of what they are contributing to? The Palestinian refugees have lost all hope that UNRWA will make any effort to return them to their original lands, which we call in the right of return. And they believe that they will have to settle for compensations. But they are concerned that if they don't bring pressure to bear on UNRWA, these monies too will be swallowed up by its organization apparatus. In my opinion, it is essential to carry out a comprehensive investigation within the refugee camps throughout the entire Middle East. Not only to sustain and to precise the number of refugees, but also to understand what the Palestinians want for themselves, that they wish for, and what they believe they can reasonable expect. In the eyes of the Palestinians, UNRWA acts as a state with its own foreign policy. And that foreign policy does not serve the best interest of the Palestinian refugees. I am saying this as a loyal Palestinian. I am saying this because I am concerned about the future of my people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Our second speaker is Dr. Arnon Groiss, who's the Deputy Director of IDA's Arabic Radio. And Arnon was Director of Research for the Institute for Monitoring Peace and Cultural Tolerance between 2000 and 2010, and wrote reports on schoolbooks in Egypt, Syria, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Tunisia, and the Palestinian Authority. And he's been an Arabic language journalist for over 30 years, and for 40 years, and currently director of IDA's Arabic Radio.
Thank you very much. I will start with UNRWA's role in Palestinian education. UNRWA accounts for 25% approximately of Palestinian education in West Bank and Gaza, and some schools in East Jerusalem, Jordan, Syria, and Lebanon. Now, it teaches students in grade 1 to 9 or 10, depending on the system in the host country. And it uses the curriculum provided by the host government, which creates a certain problem for UNRWA. Because UNRWA is an agency of the UN committed to the idea of peace in the Middle East or peaceful resolution of the Palestinian-Israeli or the Israeli-Arab conflict. And is also obliged to treat all member states equally, and Israel is a member state. Now, the books used by UNRWA in its schools contain very different material. First, they legitimized Israel's very existence and the presence of the Jewish population in the country. And second, the books demonized Israel as the source of all evil. And third, the books never, in all Arab countries and also in the Palestinian territories, never advocate a peaceful resolution of the conflict. Rather, they encourage armed struggle, violent struggle for the liberation of Palestine without any distinction between the areas occupied by Israel in 1967 and Israel proper, so to speak, before 1967. And I will talk about it with some examples quite later. Now, this rule by UNRWA actually perpetuates the conflict. If we take, for example, the number of students presently in the Palestinian students studying in UNRWA schools, we have a number of about 500,000 students. Now let's count the numbers during the last 60 or so years, and we approach a number quite above 2 million, in my opinion. And the graduates of those indoctrinated graduates of UNRWA are UNRWA's contribution to the conflict, actually. So it has a very dangerous role, in my opinion, regarding Palestinian education and regarding the conflict in general. I've seen the latest books printed by the Palestinian Authority, which are also taught in all schools in Palestinian territories, also in Gaza, and in some schools in East Jerusalem, and by state schools, UNRWA schools, private schools, whatever. There are a mandatory, obligatory part of the curriculum, and I've seen of the latest printed books, namely in 2012, 2013, about 150 books. You have some examples over here. You are encouraged to have a look at them. And I found out that the books are focused on three educational fundamentals regarding the conflict. First, the legitimization of Israel. Second, demonization of Israel and the Jews. And thirdly, as I said before, the armed struggle against Israel. And I would like to focus later on the issue of right of return, which is defined as the issue of every Palestinian refugee. And we are talking about something around 5 million people. I mean, original refugees and their descendants over the last 60 or so years. And the right of every one of them to come and reclaim his or her property in full, notwithstanding the present population at that place now. Let us see some examples. I will reach to my answer. it up because this is the film, the video. No, this is the video. I was supposed to be the second lecturer. Yeah, this one. Yeah. Holy places. Jews have no holy places in Palestine, Israel whatsoever. All our Muslim holy places, the Western Wall in Jerusalem, the Rachel's tomb in Bethlehem, and also the Cave of the Patriarchs in Hebron, are all Muslim places taken by Jews, taken over by Jews, and there are attempts to Judaize those holy places. These are a few examples. There are more. These are not the only examples. And here you see a photo of Rachel's tomb in Bethlehem. It's titled Bilal ben Rabah Mosque in Bethlehem. Taken from National Education, it's over here. You can have a look there at a book later on. There are no Jews in the country. Let us see the figures of, let us examine the figures of the inhabitants of Palestine. Not that long ago, 1999. There are Palestinians of the West Bank, Palestinians from Gaza, Palestinians of what is termed the interior, namely Israel proper. Before 67, they do not like to mention the words of the phrase Israel interior. They use circumlocutions such as the interior or the lands of 1948 or the Green Line, whatsoever. And this is an example. Now, the 6 million Jews living in the country are not mentioned. They are not actually considered legitimate inhabitants of the country. While the Palestinians of the diaspora, here the number is about 4.5 million people, are described as legitimate inhabitants. In my opinion, this is in a nutshell what the right of return is all about. The 6 million Jews, or 5.5 at that time, will leave, and the 4.5 million Palestinians will take their place in the country. So no holy places, no Jews, and no Israel. On the map, you can see the Arab states, and Palestine is over in the middle. It's called Palestine, no Israel at all. There is another map, which says specifically الشعب الفلسطيني جزء من الأمة العربية الإسلامية. The Palestinians contributed themselves. So no Israel on maps. What about this one? This is a map book with a question, a good question about how many years have passed since the declaration of Palestinian independence in 1988 in Algiers. And because the answer changes every year. So it's a good question, but the situation accompanying that question is very clear. Israel, the whole area is wrapped by the Palestinian, covered by the Palestinian flag. So Israel does not exist. Also in text, the land of the Asham or the Levant comprises the following states, Palestine and so on, no Israel. Israeli cities, Israeli regions, Israeli sites, whatever, are never mentioned as Israel. Haifa, for example, is a Palestinian port. And the Negev is a Palestinian region. No Israeli sites at all. Even Hebrew is erased from British mandatory stamp, reproduced in Palestinian schoolbook. You can see that the Hebrew inscription in the real, on the original stamp, has been erased in the reproduced stamp in the schoolbook. So far for the legitimization, demonization. Jews came to the country with the intention of expelling the Palestinians or even exterminating them. One example, another example, the establishment of Israel. In accordance with the UN partition resolution, is actually occupation. They do not they do not distinguish between the lands of 48 and the land of 67. They are both occupied territories. a poem. ماذا تجيب إذا ما تعدى على أهل بيتك شخص غريب and so on and so on. You can read it for yourself. It's a very demonizing and actually aggressive poem. And there is, this is a language exercise which portrays Israel as an entity killing Palestinian children in Kurds. Another one, that Israel is killing Palestinian cities. And even internal and inter-family violence in Palestinian society is attributed to Israel. And there are many accusations. I've counted during my 14-year work about 38 accusations against Israel, including aggressiveness and uprooting trees, demolition of houses, and so on and so on. It never ends, actually. What about the third point, encouraging armed struggle against Israel? Here's an exercise following a point in which there are several verses. Several verses appear. One of them is, "Oh, good morning, oh my homeland, the morning of glory and red liberty, watered by the blood of the martyrs." At the bottom on the right, okay? And the students, of course, should connect it to the right place, which is the second from top on the left, the hope for the liberation of Palestine. So the struggle continues up to this day, in spite of the Oslo Agreement. Now, this armed struggle, or violent struggle against Israel, is enhanced by Islam traditional ideals of jihad, and here we can see the first verse of a poem titled Palestine, and talking about the need to go to jihad against Israel, and also by the other ideal, which is martyrdom, shahada. And here are excerpts from a poem named Shahid or Martyr. And you can see for yourself, hearing weapons clashes present in my ear, and the flow of blood gladdens my soul, as well as a body thrown upon the ground, skirmished over by the desert predators. And at the end, you find a verse which actually encourages the students. This is for grade 7, so 12, 13 years old. Students, by your life, this is the death of men, and whoever asks for another death, there it is. Now I would like to talk a little bit about the right of return issue. Now, the right of return is something which is connected to Palestinian refugees only throughout the whole world. No other nation is entitled, according to this view, to the right of return. All the millions of refugees of the 20th century have settled somewhere else, not in the original countries, and are still being settled right now. But the Palestinians 60 years ago, the refugees of 60 years ago, and their descendants are, according to this view, entitled to come back to the house. And now, how this right is taught in UNRWA schools? First, the ideological level. Palestine belongs to the Palestinians themselves. The Jews are foreigners. They have Atma, which is really ambitions. And they were supported by British imperialism. The Atma began in the 19th century, the British imperialism support was in the 20th century, and later on the UN participated in this scheme with the resolution, partition resolution, and then war broke out. Nobody speaks about the responsibility of the Arab side, the Palestinian side, in that war, and which actually meant to dismantle Jewish presence in the country, because there were some places which were occupied actually by the Arab armies in that war, Gush Etzion, and in the Jewish quarter of the old city in Jerusalem, and Kfar Dawum and Nitzanim, and other places all over the country, very few, thank God. And not a single Jew was left alive. In the best case, they were all driven towards the Jewish lines, as happened to the Jews of the Jewish folk in Jerusalem. In the worst case, they were all massacred, as happened to Faretzion, to the people of Faretzion. In other cases, they were just taken prisoner, men, women, children, in Jordan, the other villages of Gush Etzion, and where they were too few to be taken to a camp, they were put in prison. The people of the surviving inhabitants of Mishmar HaYarden were put in a mother prison near Damascus, men and women, and that is the case of the inhabitants of Nitzanim, who were put in Al-Abbasiyah prison in Cairo. So it was a vicious attack against Jewish presence, and they then never said that. War broke out, and the Palestinian and the Israeli gangs, terrorist gangs, forced the Palestinians out of the country. There are many Palestinians in the world, most of them refugees, who dream to come, who wish to come back to their home. The camp is not considered an original home for the Palestinian refugees. It's a temporary place and so on, and every Palestinian dreams to return to peace or her village or city. And there are stories also encouraging this idea. Here a grandfather gives the deeds of the house in the coastal plain and the keys of the house to his grandson, and grandson promises to keep them. Language exercises. The refugee dreams of returning to his homeland. And poems. Now, poems are quite a decisive element in this story of the right of return, because they make it inevitable and put within this idea, this view, and this notion. The element of the emotional element, and they also reveal, unlike any other items in this field, reveal the violent character of the return, because return is right, not a privilege, and as such, it is not dependent. It's not part of the peace process. It is not dependent on Israel's goodwill. It's violent, and it can be taken, it's a violent return. Now we have one poem, "We Shall Return," with some hints regarding violence. It's not real violence. Thousands of victims shall return, victims of oppression shall open every door of Jewish places, of course. And now there's another poem. "We are returning," and you can see here jihad, struggle, blood, sacrifice, and returning to youth, returning to jihad in the hills, to harvest in the land, and so on. This is the violent part of the right of return. I would like to add some, 2 minutes. UNRWA has schools, about 250 schools in Gaza, and Gaza is ruled by Hamas. Now Hamas has printed a year and a half ago, new national education textbooks with some severe material which does not appear in the West Bank. And it is taught in UNRWA schools in Gaza. One of them is Palestine is all Islamic, and it is not, there is no any way of doing any compromise, territorial compromise, in order to get to peace. This is one. Another thing, violent armed struggle is the only way of liberation. And the emphasis on liberation struggle. Another thing is that part of the violent struggle of liberation is suicide attacks, which is called in Arabic al-amaliyat al-istishhadiyya, namely action that one wants to be a shaheed in order to get it, namely to commit suicide. Another point, which is very serious, and it's found very little in Palestinian books talking in the West Bank, but here you find it that characters of the characteristic of the Jews. A pure anti-Semitic piece taught in UNRWA schools in Gaza. Now UNRWA says that he is not obliged to take his books and teach them in its schools. And they deny all the time our findings that these books are really taught in UNRWA schools in Gaza. But I found the exams, the mid-year exams of last year, in an internet site, and the exam, as you can see, with the UN UNRWA logo. اختبار نهاية الفصل الأول, or text or test of the end of the first term, first semester, and it covers several school subjects, and one of them, on the left, you can see third, national education, and all the questions relate to answers from the books, which they said they don't teach. And this is that was for 8th grade, and this is for 9th grade. Also, the third part is also national education, also some questions taken from the book of grade 9, which it says, UNRWA says it doesn't teach in this book. And you can see for sure UNRWA's logo here. Now, in my opinion, I would like to conclude by that, it's the responsibility of UNRWA to accommodate the idea of peaceful resolution to the conflict, and the donor states, in my opinion, should see to it that it changes its focus in its education process and try to be more compatible with UN resolutions and UN ideas. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is David Bedein, who's director of the Centre for Near East Policy Research. And David is a community organiser, a writer, and an investigative journalist. He established the Centre for Near East Policy Research and the Israel Resource News Agency in 1987. David.
Thank you very much. First of all, just to compliment Dr. Groiss's presentation. Page chapter 5 in the book that you have in front of you, if you don't have it, please take it, is a presentation. If many of you were taking copious notes, on page 53, you see it right there, the UNRWA educational system. In addition, why are we speaking to you? Because the people who, and this is the encouraging them, if UNRWA's educational activities were funded by Riyadh and Tehran, it would not be appropriate for us to appear in the parliaments of Riyadh or Tehran. Perhaps I could get kosher food, I'm not sure. What's important to understand is this. The agency that's welcomed here today, the Henry Jackson Society, is named for someone whom I had the pleasure of meeting when I was a young 20. Henry Jackson, one of the liberators of the concentration camps, used to say, silence in the face of adversity is not an option. Henry Jackson, as a United States Senator, and I moved from the United States 44 years ago, at the age of 20, I will not ask you to figure out how old I am now. Senator Jackson discovered the most important way and process to influence a totalitarian system. Holding back funds. Those of you who are not familiar with the Jackson-Vanik Amendment, which changed history in 1972 and inspired 35 ladies of the London 35, if any of you are here or daughters or granddaughters of them, please come forward. But 35 women here in London were inspired by the Jackson-Vanik Amendment. What was that? Deny favored trade status to the Soviet Union so long as they kept up their oppression of Soviet Jews. and it worked. That year, we saw 50,000 Jews allowed to emigrate from the Soviet Union. The methodology we suggest to you today, and we're going to 18 parliaments with private funding, independent of the government of Israel or any government, which is to send to the leading funders of UNRWA. And by the way, the schoolbooks put out by the PA thank the Western countries for publishing the books and for printing the books. Very important. And so that when we get a letter, we were here, Louise was at our forum on March 30th at the House of Commons, and several constituents saw the horrendous issues in these schoolbooks, wrote to MPs, and the Foreign Office said, our research does not exist based on what we're told. Well, we're here today to reinforce the issue that unfortunately the spokesman said that perhaps we are in the habit of fabricating sources. In a moment you'll see one of our films, and fabricating films. Perhaps we have an UNRWA Universal Studios in our backyard, but we don't. Now, there are no coincidences. Coinciding with today's session here in London is the beginning of an investigation of the United Nations into UN facilities in Gaza during the summer and the role played by UNRWA in Gaza during the summer of 2014. Now that's happening now. Today it begins. Now our agency, again emphasizing we work independent of any government, warned our nations that UNRWA facilities, not only UNRWA education facilities, not only had been dominated by a curriculum which is filled with insight into war, but in addition, we took security people and Palestinians themselves who researched the takeover of Hamas, of UNRWA by Hamas in those schools. Exactly a year and a half ago, our agency sat at the head of DFID, that's the British agency in charge of passing on funds to UNRWA, and we gave them the evidence, as we did with USAID and other agencies. Here's the evidence. Here's everything you need to see. Here are films, which part of what you're going to see now, updated, of the fact that UNRWA actually operates paramilitary training in the schools. Please, we're making a very clear, reasonable request. Since Hamas is defined by the US, by the UK, by Canada, by Australia, by the EU as a terrorist organization, and laws exist on the books which forbid aid to an agency that engages the services of a terrorist organization, please ask UNRWA to dismiss UNRWA, to dismiss Hamas employees. I want to be very clear about something. It's hard to have credibility when you bring such a, in a sense, spectacular issue to the attention of the media. Because who would believe it, especially since mainstream reporters don't seem to be looking at it. However, in July of 2014, missiles were discovered in the same schools that we had revealed, which were taking place, our military training was taking place. It's all described in chapter 6 of this book. Very clear, factual, and by the way, an expression, since I learned this in the field of social work, one of the things we learned in community organization practice and in criminology is that immoral adversaries make stupid mistakes. And what they did was, what UNRWA does constantly, the schools, the principals, is they film themselves. They're very proud of it. In the same way that when we used to film Arafat, what he was saying in Arabic, he had no hesitation. He actually complimented yours truly on the fact that we were showing what he was saying to his own people. And how did we get the school books in the first place? I had an interview with Arafat 18 years ago. Mr. Arafat, when are you going to say words of peace in the Arabic language? He says, David, don't worry. We'll have a new school system, new school books. And he gave our agency a letter enabling us to buy the new school books, which was exactly what we did. We went to the most neutral of sources, the Vatican, with whom we had an interreligious dialogue. And the Pope's ambassador, His Excellency Archbishop Pietro Sambi, ordered a translation and asked for a Vatican translation of the schoolbooks. And when he came back to me, he said, off the record, when the Pope, Pope John Paul II, had come to the UNRWA camp of Dehesha, he said to him, quote, "I smell Nazi Germany. I want to know what they are teaching their children." So then the Vatican put out a study, and that study said, in the Vatican's words, that these are manuals for war, not for peace. As a result, the Italian government pulled out of the project. However, the schoolbooks continue, despite the fact that the Vatican itself, which we used to kid him, you know, you're not, you, no one could accuse you, Archbishop Selby, of being a Zionist, even though both your boss and I both were people. There is no way of doubting that kind of credibility. 14 years later, the same curriculum exists, the same denial exists. Our way of fighting denial is to film the schools, the film teachers, and we've produced six films, six of which you're going to see right now. The seventh is on the way as we raise funds to produce a new film of what's happening in the UNRWA schoolyards at this time during riots and attacks. The most recent attack in Hanof, where four rabbis were murdered in Hanof, which is located in Deir Yassin, what was Deir Yassin in Arab village, and the celebrations in UNRWA schools following that attack, because they said, well, we have a right to kill those who live in our villages. It's something not to be believed until you see it. So let's show one short film now. If you have patience, we'll show another one at the end of today's presentation about the classroom. But first, let's see something which was produced only 2 months ago, called UNRWA Goes to War. And hopefully, what you see today will resonate in the UNRWA and the United Nations Investigation Commission. But what we need the most is your voices. Your voices as citizens of a Western country. You'll see on page 10, the Great Britain, its contribution is approximately $47 billion. This is a figure of three years ago, but it hasn't changed. It's approximately the same. You can have an influence. There's an old expression, a problem is a problem when someone makes it into a problem. And please, take a second book, send it to someone of influence, an MP, whatever, and make sure you get an answer, and make sure that the answer is clearly sourced. Say what they say doesn't exist, well please, what does exist? So let's show a short film now, and we'll open up the questions. A short film, go right ahead, please.
Thank you.
And thank you again to the Henry Jackson Society. I feel emotional as I remember the legacy of Henry Jackson.
Is Hamas or militant groups, Islamic Jihad, are they launching rockets nearby these shelters, these UN schools?
The armed groups are firing their rockets into Israel from the vicinity of UN facilities and residential areas, absolutely.
80% of rockets were just shot right next to where we're standing.
These images from the Gaza war are striking, but few know that Western taxpayers funded terrorists who launched aerial attacks at innocent civilians.
This rocket launching site is right next to a UN facility.
At least 30 missiles were fired from United Nations Gaza facilities during the summer war. How did that happen? Enter UNRWA, or the United Nations Relief and Works Agency. UNRWA serves descendants of Arab refugees from the 1948 war and has an annual budget of $1.2 billion. The United States is the lead donor and gives $300 million each year. With UNRWA operating in Jerusalem, Gaza, and the West Bank, and other locations, more and more Western donors now question just how much UNRWA humanitarian aid winds up in the hands of Hamas. This scenario has developed despite all major donors designating Hamas a terrorist organization. In Gaza, UNRWA acts as a branch of Hamas. Since 1999, UNRWA teachers and worker unions have overwhelmingly elected Hamas leaders to run UNRWA Gaza facilities. With 11,500 employees in Gaza and hundreds of millions of dollars pouring into its local UNRWA offices, tens of thousands of families depend on UNRWA funding to survive. However, UNRWA administrators, loyal to Hamas, are in charge of the money. These days, there's no hiding the UNRWA-Hamas connection. This summer, on three occasions, UNRWA found missiles in its own schools. Yet to this day, no one knows what happened to the missiles. During the war, a booby-trapped building with an UNRWA health clinic sign was detonated, killing three IDF soldiers inside. Also, UNRWA supplies were used by Hamas to build its longest terror tunnels under Israeli territory. This collusion appears to be routine business for UNRWA, given the Hamas takeover of UNRWA schools. Despite U.S. government protests, Suhail al-Hindi, boss of the Gaza Teachers Union and Hamas strongman, continues to run the educational system. This system recruits and provides paramilitary training to young Hamas followers. Above all, Hamas has nurtured a cruel loyalty, most evident with UN students and their families acting as human shields to protect Hamas missile launchers. While the UNRWA slogan is "Peace starts here," a more appropriate definition might be "War starts with UNRWA." One of UNRWA's newest employees is Mohammed Asaf, a singer from Gaza whose mother taught in UNRWA schools. Asaf is now UNRWA's official youth ambassador.
I have received in this room heads of state, prime ministers, many important people, but I have never seen so much expectation here.
Even though his songs repeatedly praise martyrs and violence, he was still hired by the United Nations and is now the public face of UNRWA. Hired to promote peace, Asaf seems determined to do the opposite. His latest song, released during the Gaza War, encourages martyrdom, jihad, and a Palestinian state that replaces all of Israel. Responsible for most of the schools in Gaza and the West Bank, UNRWA has adopted a war curriculum. UNRWA schoolbooks stress jihad, martyrdom, denial of Israel, and the return of all refugees by force of arms and missiles to Arab villages that existed before 1948. The Gaza battle may be on hold, but the indoctrination continues with the new school year. How does Hamas gain favor with Palestinian youths? It organizes paramilitary after-school activities known as Al-Kutla clubs. The clubs emulate Hamas leaders, honor dead terrorists, and conduct rallies and marches for jihad or holy war. Meanwhile, UNRWA's schools in the West Bank may now be on the verge of explosion. UNRWA students openly parade in the streets and call for Israel's destruction. All of this occurs in plain sight, within the watchful eye of UNRWA teachers. These students are between the ages of 8 and 10 and have already received military training. Here they are, pictured with toy guns. But there's nothing childish about their message or actions.
We're going to be able to get the money. عشان بلده ترتاح ويموت بسببها يعني انه يموت شهيد ويرتاح في الدنيا مش يشوف اهله يتعذب.
انت حابب تكون شهيد؟
ان شاء الله الحمد لله حابب.
حي رجال القسامية اوتاد فلسطين احراس فلسطين اوتاد الارض الابية طلاب الياسين بالقران وبندقية
طب صرخة عز الدين. حسب رأيك يا أستاذ اللي حصل في غزة بينمي روح الشهادة عند الأجيال هنا؟
طبعا أكيد تنمي روح الشهادة.
نعم.
ولأنهم صح أصحاب قضية أصحاب حق أصحاب يعني أصحاب حقهم. فمهما كان راح يظل في ناس طالعين في ناس الجاهل في ناس القاوم هذا الدوار الغاشم.
احنا سألنا اليوم بعض الطلاب كتير عبروا عن شعورهم انهم حابين يكونوا شهداء. شو رأيك يا أستاذ؟
يعني هم يعني بشكل عام.
نعم.
يعني لما نقول انه الشهادة أجرها كبير عند الله.
نعم.
فهم يعني حابين.
بيسألوك شو معنى الجهاد يا أستاذ؟
بيسألوني شو معنى.
شو بتقول لهم يا أستاذ؟
انه الجهاد من له منزلة عليا عند الله تعالى.
نعم. وإنه هذا فرض.
هذا فرض على كل شخص وكل فرد موجود في تحت مجتمع خاصة حلقة. بسألوني يقولون لي يعني مثلا الصواريخ خالية يعني لازم نطلقها. لازم نرد على العدوان. طبعا لازم نرد على العدوان.
لو في إيدي بروح أكاتب مع أطفال غزة ونفسي إنه يعني إنه نكون إن إحنا ننتصر وحتى إنه نقهر العدو الإسرائيلي.
طيب شفت الصور مثل إسرائيل؟
أكيد فرحنا كثير كان يعني عنا يوم هذا عيد لما نزلت الصواريخ حتى العبيد كان معنا كنا كثير فرحانين يعني وكنا متمنين يا ريت دائما هيك يصير.
ألف مبروك لغزة وإن شاء الله إنه دائما ننصر.
طيب كنت شو كان شغلك لما كانت الصواريخ اللي حطيتكم مقاومة على الصواريخ؟
بكيت فرح جدا إنه كتاب مكسرة تضرب على إسرائيل ويأخذوا وخطفوا منهم مثل جنود جاءوا الأرواح وجنود كثير.
كنت مبسوط لأنه لما نزلت على تل أبيب خاصة إنه الكل بيضرب على تل أبيب يا ضي عملوها الفدائية هينا خطفنا جند جديد أكبر الحمية.
الحمد لله أنا قصة غزة هذا رسل الله وفخرنا الكبير فيها. يا رب تدم عليها النص يا رب تنصرهم تشفي كل مرضاها وتدخل شهداهم الجنة.
شو رأيك اللي بيصير بغزة؟
الله يكون معكم ويسلم الأخوان ويسلم الناس الله يخليهم إن شاء الله
احنا بنتصرف. بالجغرافيا إسرائيل موجودة على الخارطة؟
لا مش موجودة.
شو موجودة؟ موجودة
فيها في
العكس وغزة. إسرائيل ما فيهاش موجودة؟ بدرسوكم عن الجهاد مثلاً؟ شو بيقولوا؟
كنا نجاهد وكنا نقوم بالرجال وكنا يعني سلاح للرجال وكنا نقوم فيها بأي شيء يعني عشان نطلعهم وما نخليهم مش محتاجين أرضهم.
طيب بالمدرسة بتتعلموا ايش طعام اسرائيل؟
ان احنا بنعترفش بدولة اسمها اسرائيل اللي هي الدولة المحتلة.
بالخارطة في وجود لاسرائيل على الخارطة شو موجود؟
القدس وبيرنا والرب والعبد.
بدرسوك عن حق العودة؟
بالاكيد.
شو بدرسوك؟
كمان انه ان لازم نرجع ارضنا وهاي ارضنا يعني لازم نرجع ارضنا 48.
شو بقولوا لك في التاريخ عن دولة اسرائيل؟
انه هذه مش بلدهم، هم اجوا احتلونا وهم مشردين مش معروف من وين هم، واجوا احتلوا فلسطين وفيش اشي اسمه اسرائيل لانه هاي ارض فلسطين.
بدرسوك عن المقاومة؟ شو بقولوا لك؟
انه المقاومة انه احنا لازم جميعنا نأيد المقاومة، المقاومين هم اللي لازم يرجعونا بلدنا وهيك، واللي بتاخد بالقوة بترجع شغل بالقوة.
الجهاد بدرسوه؟ شو بقولوا لك؟
نجاهد ضد الاحتلال.
بتعملوا فعاليات في قلب المدرسة؟
بنطلع مصيرات وبنأيدهم وهيك.
هم بيطلبوا منكم تطلعوا؟
هم بيطلبوا منا نعمل مصيرات.
الإدارة؟ مصيرات لايش؟
مصيرات ضد الاحتلال وتشجيع المقاومة.
شو بالتاريخ بقولوا لك عن دولة إسرائيل؟
إسرائيل إنها إرهابية وشعب حكوم. وإنه شعب إرهابي ويقتل الناس في غزة ونحن سنقاوم حتى النهاية في رمي الحجارة وطلع مصيرات حول الاحتلال الإسرائيلي
عن حق العودة. قولوا لك
زي ما أخذوه إحنا نرجعها في الحكومة.
شو رأيك في اليهود؟
إنه لازم نقاوم عشان يطلعوا من البلاد من عندنا، لأنه هذا مش أرضهم، هذا إلنا، هم يجوا يطرونا منها.
أيضا عربية بالتاريخ والهوية فلسطين، عربية بالتاريخ من نابلس للجليل، من ثمانية للخليل، من نابلس للجليل، ومن تنين للخليل، وإحنا بخندق واحد يوم زي السيف صارنا.
شو رأيك في اللي صار في غزة؟
إنه إشي برفع الرأس إنهم بيحرروا أرضنا وإشي وبقاوموا وهيك عشان
قالوا لك في المدرسة إنه حماس انتصرت على إسرائيل؟ وإنت مع المقاومة؟
محمد رسول الله! الله أكبر! الله أكبر! يا شهيد
acting as a tinderbox for Islamic revolution. Western democracies can no longer ignore their taxpayer funds being funneled toward terror and creating a new generation of hate. Reforming UNRWA is no longer an option. It is a necessity and is now in the hands of donor nations.
We've heard well-documented, shocking information about UNRWA's role in promoting violence and hatred, rejecting any Jewish claim to the land, and suggesting that there can't be any solution to a difficult problem. And David did say earlier on that following the previous presentation on this topic, a number of MPs did raise this issue of funding in Parliament, and that is correct. And the issue has been raised a number of times, and it was raised again very recently, but always the same answer comes back. The Foreign Office have looked at this and cannot find any information. Now, I just report that to you. Clearly, we have to continue doing it and have to be on with more information, which I think we have. But this issue has been repeatedly raised by a number of MPs over some time, including very recently, and it's one of the ongoing challenges that we've all got. Questions? I'm going to take two or three together in that case. Yes, can you give your name, please?
Michael Levine.
ex-deputy general manager of the UK, retired actually, ex rather than fired. There was an article just this morning in Allgemeine, headline, UN says it can't feed Syrian refugees as UNRWA raises billions for Palestinians. There is only so much international aid to go around, and no one reason why the World Food Programme is running out of money is because the bloated, superfluous UNRWA keeps on manufacturing its own crises every couple of months to keep its own cash coming. Last week, UNRWA declared an emergency because the flooding in Gaza that did not kill or injure a single person. While the WFP needs some 64 million a month to stop people from starving, UNRWA is demanding 1.6 billion from the international community on top of 300 million it demanded earlier this year. The article then goes on in more detail if anybody
wants
to. What do you have to say about this demand for more and more cash?
Yes, Dr. Groiss, thank you very much for giving us such up-to-date material. Nick Gray from the Middle East Watch. Can you tell me how much of today's syllabus is copy or a reproduction of the old Jordanian syllabus, and how much of it is new material, completely new material?
Thank you.
I'm Alan Melton. Coming to the Foreign Office, the excuse about not giving you information, or not having information, the evidence seems pretty overwhelming. What do you suspect? Maybe other reasons why they keep crossing out the same excuse.
Right, and he goes to the panel. Funding issues from UNRWA,
short and sweet, then to my two experts. First things first, our agency has conducted these briefings in the Knesset, inviting all of the donors. Representatives of the Foreign Office saw these films. Representatives of the Foreign Office saw the curriculum. Representatives of the Foreign Office were very appreciative of the fact that we presented this to them. They went back to Tel Aviv and said it doesn't exist. That's the issue, is that they're not under enough pressure, in my opinion, from constituents. In other words, yeah, a few have written, but not enough. And there has not been enough of an expose of what's going on here. But again, for them to say they haven't seen it, when we saw three briefings in the Knesset with the Foreign Office, there's a problem. Now, the expose of the line has to be stronger and has to be more clear. And until the summer, what we were saying over the years, and it was 11 years ago when we came to London with the information that Hamas had taken over one of our facilities. And it's been denied ever since. Well, my suggestion, ladies and gentlemen, since you can't get the mainstream media too much to report it, a problem is a problem, and someone makes it a real problem. Bombard them with the evidence and say you're not going to go away until there is a resolution of this issue. Because it's very easy to say everything, everyone wants peace. There is an organization called Americans for American Friends of Women, financed in part by a gentleman from the UK named Daniel Eden. I think that he has to be confronted. He's also a person who helped start an organization known as J Street. Has to be confronted with an issue of integrity, which has to be raised.
Would you
like to comment? Yeah, towards your question, I think that's exactly what I said, that while Palestinians are suffering more, UNRWA is getting more and more contributions from the international community. I think that the situation in Gaza is much more worse than we can desire. In the meantime, I know that there are around over 100,000 Palestinians who are doing homeless without houses, and they became even more and more frustrated on UNRWA, because UNRWA is just delivering promises. Yeah, it's not only to reconstruct his house, but UNRWA still promising people that one day they will drive him back to his original, the so-called original homeland, which is, in my opinion, why you are promising people and you couldn't fulfill your promise, it's also a war crime. So this is UNRWA, and this is why the most of the Palestinians, refugees, not only in the territories but also in the diaspora, are not really believe or trusting that is such organization will fulfill their promises for me. Yeah.
My answer about the books, this is a totally new project, a school book publication project started by the Palestinians in 2000. Actually, there were some experimental books issued already in 1995 and 96, which is called National Publications, because the whole system was either Jordanian or Egyptian. They didn't want the books to be Jordanian-oriented or Egyptian-oriented books. So they issued their own books, and the first one to be published were books of national education, because national education in the whole system was Jordanian or Egyptian. So they started with that. And by the way, in the whole book of the Palestinian book of national education of 1996, Rachel Stone is still called Rachel Stone. And only in 2001, they replaced it with the Mosque of Gilad ben Rabah. So we are witnessing a gift in the making. So this is only new project financed by foreign countries, also European countries. It began with Italy, they withdrew, Belgium remained, other organizations and so on. And this is new. No Jordanian, no Egyptian.
Several more answers. Yes. Yes, you for me?
Yes.
Okay. It's just, my name is Sonia Graham. I actually live in Israel, by the way. I was just trying to understand, it's pre-election times in the UK now, you were saying something about constituents putting pressure on the MPs. Surely there are now organisations that are pro-Israel, or constituents, or groups of constituents that can actually put pressure on the local MPs, isn't this the right time to do it?
Yes, I think many of us here must be struggling to understand what the UK and US and other national governments perceive as their interests in ignoring this issue deliberately and knowingly ignoring it. And I have no idea, but surely you do as an MP, you must have some idea of why the Foreign Office is obfuscating. Why?
Jerry Lewis, correspondent for Israel Radio and Jerusalem Post. In my capacity as a journalist during the Gaza War, I was on the BBC, crossing swords with somebody who's pretty well known in this country as an UNRWA spokesman, Chris Dunnis. And after his mini presentation, they just challenged him as to why, or what happened to the weaponry that UNRWA confiscated from their educational establishments. And was it true that they'd be handed back to Hamas? And he was very, very evasive. He got very ratty. He then decided not to answer the call and questioned my credentials. Do you have any information as to exactly what happened to the weaponry, why UNRWA would be less than willing to have that exposed? And secondly, could I just ask in parentheses, in your excellent, otherwise excellent film, there was one line which made me very worried. And I go back, it must be 15 years ago, when we had a debate in the other building, and the late David Cairns, who was the chairman of Labour Friends of Israel, stood up and raised the whole issue of these books. And he was told by Peter Hain not to believe all the propaganda given out. Peter Hain was then the Foreign Office Minister, not to believe all the propaganda that your side had put together about these particular publications. You've produced very well extracts from these books, so we can see what there is. But in the film it said,
UNRWA is a branch of Hamas. Can you substantiate that claim?
First of all, the last question is the most important question. In 1999, there were elections for the UNRWA Teachers Union and the UNRWA Workers Union in Gaza. Hamas won to the tune of about 78%. In 2003, their next election, we assigned a Palestinian staff to cover the election. In 2008, when they had another election, the Middle East Subcommittee of the European Parliament financed us to do it again. The numbers are now, in the 2012 election, each of these elections, reached the figure of 92% Hamas who are running the Administrators Union and the Teachers Union of Gaza. What does that mean? Those are very big words, unions. It means the people who handle the funds. If you hand over funds to Gaza, to the UNRWA schools in Gaza, to the UN administration in Gaza, it goes in the hands of the administrators who are also Hamas. Openly, they don't kid around. They say exactly who they are and what they're doing. And this is the most important thing to understand. Now, we were very sensitive to those who said that this was propaganda, which is why we hired professionals, which is why we hired Palestinians, who are loyal and proud Palestinians, to show what is going on. And the coincidence of engaging the services, which I never expected to do in my life, of the Vatican, to give, excuse me for the word, the picture, understanding what is in these books. We thought that we were naive and thought that after the Vatican endorsed these conclusions, it would bring about some monumental change. However, that didn't happen. So the issue is that UNRWA is dominated by Hamas and will continue to be dominated by Hamas, and the fact that they make things run on time and run a more efficient boat than the PA does, means they may be less corrupt, but more violent. But make something very clear, also in terms of our terminology. We no longer call this curriculum a curriculum of hatred. That was from Arafat's time. This is a curriculum of war. As a social work professional, when I see the children and interface with them, and always not an Israeli, sometimes I have my kippa undercover with a hat. I play the American reporter, I just hope that also can see it coming out. But I play the American reporter, and I can get to see them in action. I don't see children who are frothing at the mouth, neither did you see the children frothing at the mouth in this production. You see a systematic method of preparing the kids for war. And if this was only coming out of a Hamas facility financed by the Saudis or the Iranians, we couldn't do anything about it. But because it's coming from the West, and you know, the UN, anything which is UN, yours truly, when I grew up, UN was associated with Eleanor Roosevelt and the tragic loss of Dr. Hammarskjöld. October 24th, UN Day, was celebrated as a holiday. It has a certain sanctity to it. To this day in the media. However, asking the media, and by the way, your interaction with the mainstream media is extremely important, because the idea that most media people have is that if it's in the UN, it must be okay, it must be feeding us. So there's a couple of indiscretions. But here, and perhaps it's almost, forgive me for saying it, almost an anti-Semitic notion, that because Jews are involved in translating Palestinian schoolbooks, there must be something wrong. And that's why we ask people to look at the facts, to look at the books. And by the way, I'll give you a newsworthy item since we have a journalist here. There is a Palestinian curriculum for peace. Israel's former president, Shimon Peres, we talk about it all the time. It was being created at Beirut University, a Palestinian university. One problem, it was vetoed by the Palestinian Authority, openly. So it does exist. It is an alternative education system. It is not in. And they're not being used because it advocates the two-state solution rather than what we call this two-stage solution. And that there is no educational institution, not in the Palestinian Authority, not in UNRWA, that promotes reconciliation or recognition of Israel as a peace partner. That should be very clear. However, their ability,
and Abbas's ability to convey misinformation. And someone was asking, what's the source? Why is the Foreign Office and other foreign ministries in the U.S. State Department so clear in saying that what we're saying is a lie? Because Mr. Abbas, trained by the Soviets, he knows what he's doing. When he meets with reporters, or diplomats, or journalists, the first words out of his mouth are, oh, we have to stop Palestinian incitement. He disarms you. And you get so disarmed, you forget to ask him, well, by the way, what was on the Palestinian Authority media last month? What is in your schoolbooks? What about your proclamations? What about your incentives to those who murder Jews? But you forget because he dominates the conversation with diplomats, with journalists, with public officials, saying how much he denounces incitement. Arafat wasn't like that. This guy is much smarter, and we're preparing a system which is very, very convincing. And he learned from the Soviets, his 10 years in the Soviet Union at the Patricia Lumumba Institute, where, by the way, this is something, if I had Senator Jackson sitting here, I would put it in front of him, by the way, his doctoral thesis, which denies that the Nazis carried out the murder of the 6 million, he said that maybe the Zionists did it, is in every school in the Palestinian Authority at UNRWA. Wouldn't it be a reasonable request to ask to remove that book?
I do think it's important that the general election coming, but not if there wasn't, but that everybody makes their views known and makes representations of their MP. It doesn't matter who the MP is, it doesn't matter what you think the existing views of the MP are. And all MPs at the moment are being absolutely bombarded with pro-Palestinian, deeply anti-Israel campaigns. And for even MPs who are supportive of Israel, it can be very demoralising, and the only pushback that you get is deeply, deeply hostile. So very, very important that your views are made known. Now, I'm trying to get more people in and getting a quarter time. So that's it, a few pounds I'll take. One in the corner there, the gentleman here, and the colleague at the back there, and we'll see if we can talk about it.
David, I'm all in favour of this sort of funding, these educational programs being stopped, but what practical difference do you think it would make if they were stopped, if Saudi, the likes of Saudi Arabia could simply pick up the tab? How confident can you be that you would?
Yes, Jonathan Lutz. Is it an argument to vis-a-vis donor states, at least those states that are voting to recognize a Palestinian